Hello and welcome. In this video, we'll discuss chapter number 4 of subject CT4, that is the two-state Markov model. Okay, so before starting the topic, I would like to build up some background on it. Okay, so far we have been discussing about Markov processes, right? We had discussed the Markov property and then we started talking about the Markov processes, right? And we have discussed two types of Markov processes so far. So any stochastic process which exhibits the Markov property, that is the future states, can be modeled completely based on the present, and the past state does not provide any additional information for predicting the future, is called as a Markov process, right? And this is of two types of Markov processes have been discussed in subject CT4. The first one was with a discrete state space and a discrete time set, right? And this was called as a Markov chain, right? So this is what we have already discussed in chapter number 3 of subject CT4. This was called as Markov chain, right? And the next type of process that we would be discussing now is a Markov process with a discrete state space but a continuous time set, right? So your time set would be continuous, and this is referred to as a Markov jump process, right? And in this chapter we'll be starting with Markov jump processes, which would be continued in the next two chapter, that is chapter number 5 and 6 of subject CT4, right? So talking about this particular type of Markov jump process, which is called as the two-state Markov model. Let's get to two-state Markov model. So this model, it is used to model the mortality of human lives. The basic idea is that we are modeling the mortality of human lives. So there are basically only two states that a human life can be in, okay? There are only two states in which a human life can exist in, and those are alive and dead, okay? These are the two states when you talk about the mortality of a human life, okay? Any life can transition, any life exists in the alive state and they can transition into the dead state. So basically here your state space becomes, when you're making this kind of a model, your state space becomes alive and dead, right? So it's a discrete state space, as you can see, okay? And your time domain, your J, becomes, if you talk about it, see, when I talk about a human life transitioning from alive to dead state, they can transition at any point of time, right? They won't only transition at the end of the year. A person won't only die at the end of the year, or they won't only die at the middle of the year. They can die at any point of time during their life. So time domain becomes, it will start from zero. Okay, they can die between any time from zero to infinity, right? So your time domain, as you can see, it is continuous. And thus, a two-state model, which models the mortality of human lives, it is a Markov jump process because it has a discrete state space and a continuous time domain, right? So I can write that this is a MJP, that is a Markov jump process. Okay, now let's just discuss a few important notations relating to the Markov jump process, and you would be very familiar with these notations if you have already studied subject CT5, right? In CT5, this Markov jump process, since it is the process of transition of a state from a alive to a dead state and it models the mortality of human lives, it forms the basis of subject CT5, because there you are valuing life insurance contracts based on the probabilities of living and dying, okay? So the two-state model, it forms the foundation structure of on which the subject CT5 develops, right? So the notations here are very similar to subject CT5 and you would be very familiar, but the approach would be a bit different, right? So let's just see what is said here, okay? So this is given in CT5 as well and it's given here. Okay, so the first notation is TQX, which is the probability of death. Okay, let's try to see what this means. Okay, so in subject CT5 in particular, TQX is the probability that a person aged X dies by the age X plus T. So this person has to be alive at this age X, okay? And then he has to die at any time before age X plus T. Right, so at this point of time he has to be dead, okay, and that is how we define it in form of a conditional probability. So it says that it is the probability that a person is in dead state at age X plus T. So he has to be dead at age X plus T, given that this is for conditional probability. This means this is read as given that, right? You must remember from subject CT3. Okay, so given that the person is in alive state at age X, okay, so he has to be alive at age X and then he has to be dead at age X plus T, right? So we had two states here. We had the state which was alive and we had the state which was dead. So at age X, he has to be in the alive state and then he has to transition from alive to dead at any point of time between these two. So he'll be in the dead state at age X plus T, okay? So this was the first probability, okay, based on this alive and dead model, right? So he can transition at any point of time between ages X and X plus T, and I want this probability, okay? So this was the first one. The second one is called as TPX, and this in subject CT5 is referred to as the survival probability. So survival probability is the probability that this person who's aged X, he's alive at this time and then he stays alive at age X plus T, okay? So he has to be alive here as well, right? So he's alive here and he's alive at age X plus T as well, okay? So this definition says that a person is in the alive state at age X plus T, given that he was in the alive state at age X, okay? So we know that he's in the alive state at age X, and we want the probability that he is also in the alive state at age X plus T, right? So this is the survival probability that he survives from X to X plus T throughout he survives. And this is referred to as TPX, right? Now on the next one, let's move on to the next one. This was the second one. The third one is called as the force of transition, transition rate or transition intensity. Let's just first define this and then see the notation and everything. So the force of transition or transition rate is the rate at which people are dying, okay, or the rate at which a person is dying or people are dying, okay, in a unit time period, that is one year or 1 month or whatever the time period is, given that they can die at any they can die continuously at any point of time or continuously, you can call this as in a small period of time, H, such that H tends to zero, okay? So what does this mean? See, so we want the rate at which people are transitioning from the alive state to the dead state. See, so far we have been discussing the probabilities. TPX and TQX are the probabilities, right? But right now I'm talking about the force of transition, the transition rate or the transition intensity, which is defined by the symbol mu x at age x, okay? Mu x means the transition rate at age x, right? This is the transition rate at age x, okay? And this is defined as the rate at which people are dying, or the rate at which people are transitioning from the alive state to the dead state in a unit time period, that is in 1 year or 1 month or whatever the unit of time period you consider, given that they can die continuously or they can die in a small period of time, okay? So how you can look at it is that you are at age X and you want the transition rate here, the rate at which a person can die. So the rate would be, see, you need to know that rates, any sort of rates are always defined per unit time, okay? Any sort of rates are always defined per unit time. Okay, whenever I say, let's say, when I talk about cars arriving at a signal, suppose a few cars are arriving at a signal. So I can say three cars arrive in an hour. Okay, so I'm defining it per hour. Okay, similarly, if you can say that, 20 people are dying per year. So the rate of dying would be 20 per year, right? So basically, these are always defined per unit time. Okay, so it is saying that it is the rate at which people are dying if they can die continuously. That is, they can die at any point of time during this. So they can die during any small period of time which is defined as H. Okay, H can take any value. H can be this, H can be this, or H can be this. These are all small periods of time. And they can die during any of these small period of time such that H tends to zero. So they can die, what this is saying is that they can die at any point of time during this, okay? And the point of time of death of these people is a very small period of time, which is modeled as H, such that H tends to zero. So it does not take them a lot of time to die, okay? And they can die at any point of time during this, okay? And the implication of H tending to zero is that H is so small that only one death can occur during this time. Only one death can occur during H. Okay, so that is what H means. And this will give you the rate at which the people are dying in a year if they can die in a very small period of time, right? So what is H? Now the question is, what is H? If H tends to zero, what will we take H to be? See, we need to take H to be a very small period of time. So it can be 1 hour, or it can be 1 day, or it can be 1 week, or something like that. Some small period of time in comparison to a year. And defining H totally depends up to us. Right, it depends on to us that what we consider as a small period of time during which only one death can occur. Okay, so if too many deaths are occurring, if you are a life insurance policy with a huge portfolio with a lot of people involved, then you will probably take H to be equal to an hour, okay, or a day, okay. But if you have less number of people, you can take it to be equal to a week, okay. So basically, the idea is that H has to be so small that only one death can occur during H, right? And mu X will give you the rate at which people are dying in a unit period of time, that is in a year, given that they can die continuously. They can die at any point of time, okay? And the definition, the formal definition for mu X is given as limit H tends to zero. So we already know H tends to zero. The probability that a person aged X dies in a small period of time H, so it is HQX, okay, HQX, this is the probability that the person is alive, person is dead at age X plus H, given that he was alive at age X, right? That's what it is, right? He has to die between ages X and X plus H, divided by H when limit is taken to be limit H tends to zero. Okay, so I'm just dividing the probability of death during this period of small period of time H by the time interval H. So this should give me the annual rate of death. Okay, let's try to understand the logic behind this definition. Okay, let's try to take an example. Okay, an unrelated example here, and then you can actually apply the same theory here. Okay, let's look at this very simple example, which is relating to football. Okay, so it says that if one football match is held every month, okay, so you have got a football match which is being held every month, and the probability of winning any match for a team obviously is 0.25. okay, so the probability of winning a match is 0.25. what is the annual rate at which a team is winning matches? Okay, so we want to find the rate at which per year, the rate at which a team is winning matches, right? So how will we do that? Okay, so let's try to think about it intuitively. Okay, in the year you will have 12 matches, right? In the year you'll have 12 matches, and you want the annual rate of winning matches. So you will expect that each match is independently won with a probability of 0.25, right? So you will multiply this with 0.25 in order to find the annual rate, because there are 12 matches and there is a probability 0.25 that you win any match. Okay, so out of 12 matches, you will obviously expect to win 3 matches, right? That is 1/4 of all the matches, right? You can think about this in another way. Okay, if you want to find this is your rate, actually this is your rate. Okay, annual rate of winning matches, right? 3 matches per year. Now you can think about it in a different way. Okay, the other approach can be what we did in the last part in order to find mu x. Okay, it would be we said that mu x is equals to hqx, okay, limit h tends to 0 hqx upon h, right? So you just divide the probability of winning a match by the length of the interval in which we are winning. Okay, so you take a small period of time h in which only one match can be won, and you divide it with the interval length. Okay, so how can we do that? Here h would be equal to 1/12, that is 1 month, right? So h would be equal to 1/12, because it is clearly written that one football match is held every month. So at maximum you can only win one match in a month, right? So hqx would be equal to 0.25, that is the probability of winning a match in a month, that is 0.25, right? And you divide it with the interval length, that is equal to 1/12, right? So this comes out to be if you multiply it, 12 into 0.25, which is equal to 3 matches per annum, right? So what we clearly saw here was that if you divide the probability of anything by the interval length, you can get the annual rate, actually. Okay, if you divide the probability of some event happening independently in an interval and you divide it by the interval length, you can actually get the annual rate. And that is what we do in case of the two-state model, that we divide hqx by h. And thus this is your definition for the rate of death, or the transition intensity, or the force of transition. Okay, and if I try to see it how it is given in the book, they have given it in a different way. The definition given there is different. They have given this mu x at the force of transition at age x plus t, instead of giving it at age x. Okay, so that becomes mu x plus t, right? And instead of this h, they have used the value dt. Okay, so they have taken dt tends to 0, so you can just replace h by dt. Okay, so they have given this definition as limit dt tends to 0. Now dt is nothing but a small value of time, okay, small interval of time that tends to 0. Okay, so this definition, it changes. If I'm calculating mu x plus t now, this age x will become x plus t. Okay, so above you'll have the probability that a person aged x plus t dies within a very small period of time dt. So that h is replaced with the dt and dtq. Now, instead of this x, you'll have an x plus t, right? Because the age earlier was x, now it is x plus t. So dtq x plus t, and this would be divided by dt, right? So that's your definition which is given in the book, okay? So this is basically the probability of dying during a small period of time dt divided by the interval length, that is dt. And we have already seen the logic behind this formula, okay? So these are the notations related to this model. Now let's move on to the assumptions of the model. Okay, so the next thing is to look into the assumptions of the two-state Markov model. So the first assumption is that the Markov property holds, that is, the future can be completely modeled by the present and the past does not provide any additional information for modeling the future. So as it is given in the book, the probability that a life will be dead or alive at any subsequent age depends only on the ages involved and only on the current state, okay? So only on the present state and all the ages which are involved currently, only on them the probability of life or death depends, okay? So this essentially means that any past sickness, any past spell of sickness that a person had suffered in the past does not have any subsequent effect on mortality in the future, which is practically untrue. If someone has had a bad medical history in the past, they will be likely to have a higher mortality, but this model assumes otherwise, okay? So this can only be true for a homogeneous population. That is, we can only apply this model to a homogeneous population wherein all the lives have had a similar experience in the past, okay? So all the lives should be of the same type. That is only when you can actually model their mortality by the same model depending on the present state. Otherwise, any life's mortality will be affected by the past states, okay? So basically, this means that the past sickness will not affect the future mortality, which is an idealistic simplification, but then we'll have to assume it in order to apply this model. The second assumption is that dtq x plus t, that is the probability that a person aged x plus t dies within the next dt years, is equal to dt times mu x plus t, okay? Now this plus order of dt, okay? Let's this small o of dt is called as order of dt, right? Small o of dt, okay? Let's see how we get here, okay? This can be implied directly from the definition of mu x plus t. Now we know mu x plus t is equal to limit dt tends to 0. We've already discussed this. Dtq x plus t divided by dt. Okay, this is the definition, right? The probability of dying within a very short period of time dt divided by dt. Now, if I send this dt on the other side, and ignore the limit for a while, then I can write that dtq x plus t is equal to dt time mu x plus t, right? So this directly implies from this definition, if you send dt on the other side, right? But this order of dt is the extra term, and you can see the order of dt as a negligible quantity. Negligible adjustment quantity, okay? So this, you can look at it like zero itself, okay? This is almost zero, any quantity which is almost zero, right? So this is a negligible adjustment quantity, and this is almost equal to zero. That's how you can see it, okay? O of dt can almost be seen as zero. Thus, you can say that dtq x plus t, this can be approximately written as, from this definition itself, dt times mu x plus t. Right? So you can write it like this, okay? This order of dt can be seen as zero. But let's try to see what is the meaning of this order of dt exactly, okay? Let's see. So O of h, if I'm talking about any other variable h, O of h is any function of h, okay, that tends to zero faster than h itself, okay? So it is formally defined as limit h tends to zero, O of h by h is always equal to zero, okay? So it is any quantity that becomes zero, okay, faster than h itself. When h becomes zero, okay, when h becomes zero, this quantity has to become zero faster than h itself. So you can see it, for example, functions like this, h cube plus h square, okay, and you can maybe, this is the term, okay, let's say this is equal to, let's check if this is O of h or not, okay. So is this a function of h? Yes, it is. Let's check if OH by h is equal to zero or not. So O of h by h would be equal to h cube plus h square divided by h when limit h tends to zero, right? Right. So this becomes, if I cancel out the numerator and denominator, it becomes h square plus h when limit h tends to zero, which is equal to zero, because if you put zero in place of both of these, it becomes zero, right? So this is an order of h. This is an example of an order of h. But if you see another function, if you see this function h cube plus h square plus let's say h, okay, if this function, let's check for this function. So dividing it by h and tending limit h to zero, this becomes h square plus h plus one. Okay, now if you check this limit, this is equal to one. So this is not O of h, okay? So O of h is any quantity. See, you can think about it logically. See, if h is tending to zero, h cube will be a quantity which would be decreasing faster than h itself, and h, so will be h square. So this quantity would become zero faster than h. That is why it is a small O of h or order of h, right? So this term can be viewed as any negligible term. You don't need to get into the detail of it, although I've explained already, but this is any quantity which can be viewed as a negligible adjustment term, okay? So you can simply say that dtqx plus t is dt times mu x plus t, right? Approximately. This was the second assumption. And the third assumption is that there is a constant force of mortality between integer ages, okay? So this assumption we have seen in subject CT5 as well, that the force of mortality remains constant between any two ages x and x plus 1. Okay, so all the rate of mortality between ages 23 and 24, maybe let's say this, if x is equal to 23, then x plus 1 would be equal to 24. The force of mortality, the rate at which people are dying between these two ages, would be constant. Logically speaking, your force of mortality increases with increase in age, because people die at a higher rate as they age. But here we'll be assuming that this is constant for all ages between x and x plus 1, right? So it would be constant for between 23 and 24, and then it will increase, and it would be constant between 24 and 25, right? And it would be constant between 25 and 26, right? So between all integer ages, it would be constant, okay? So the same force of mortality will apply at age 23.5, and it would be same at 23.75, right? So they just formally write it as mu x plus t is equal to some constant mu, which is not dependent on t, right? It is a constant mu for all t that is between 0 and 1. Right, so it would be same for 23 to 24, right, and 24 to 25, and 25 to 26, okay? After 24 it would suddenly increase, and then it would be constant between 24 and 25, and then it would be constant between 24 and 25, and then it would suddenly increase and be constant between 25 and 26, right? So this is the third assumption, and this assumption we have seen in CT5 as well. This is referred there as CFM, constant force of mortality, that the force of mortality is assumed to be constant between integer ages, okay? So this is another assumption for the model, okay? So the three assumptions were, the first one was the Markov property holds. This is called as the Markov assumption. Okay, this is logical. Then the second assumption was that the rate of that the probability of dying in a small period of time dt is equal to that period of time multiplied by the force of mortality, right? So if you multiply dt with mu x plus t, you will get the probability of dying in this small period of time, and this can be derived directly from the definition of mu x plus t, because it is dt q x plus t divided by dt. So you just send this dt on the other side, and there is this extra term o of dt, which is any quantity which tends to zero faster than dt, right? Okay, so this is a negligible adjustment coefficient or a negligible adjustment quantity. And the third one is constant force of mortality, that is, we assume that the force of mortality remains constant between integer ages. Now that we have seen all the assumptions of the model, let's see how the model is built and how different relations can be seen between the probabilities and the force of mortality. Okay, so this is the definition of TPX in terms of the force of mortality. Okay, and this is one of the definitions that is discussed in subject CT5, but then the derivation of this definition is covered in subject CT4. Okay, so basically in subject CT5, you were told that TPX is equal to e to the power of negative integral from 0 to t mu x plus s ds, or when mu x plus s was constant, when this was a constant, this was equal to e to the power of minus mu t, right? These were some definitions that you were told in subject CT5, but the derivation for this is covered in subject CT4. So let's just get into that derivation. How do we get this definition, right? So we are trying to see the derivation. Okay, so let's start with something which is this definition. Dt plus t px, this is the probability that a person aged x survives for t plus dt years. Okay, this is the probability that you have got. Okay, this person aged x survives for t plus dt years, right? So he's alive here and he's alive here as well. Now this definition, according to subject CT5 and by common sense, can be written as the probability that a person first survives for t years, okay, a person first survives for t years and then survives for further dt years, right? So the probability that a person aged x survives for t plus dt years is same as the probability that a person aged x first survives for t years and then survives for dt years more. So this is TPX into dt p x plus t, right? This is the probability that a person aged x survives first for t years and then survives for dt years more, right? So he first goes from x to x plus t, right? He survives for t years, and then he survives, now that he is aged x plus t, he survives for dt years more. Okay, so this, his age becomes x plus t plus dt, right? So this is how you can see it, and this definition is true by common sense, right? So you can write by common sense that if you want to survive for t plus dt years, you first survive for t years, and now when you are aged x plus t, you survive for dt years more. Okay, now let's try to manipulate it and get it further. So this TPX and this TQX, DTP x plus t, this can be written as 1 minus DTQ x plus t. And the reason for this is because we already know the reason for this is that TPX, that is the survival probability, plus the death probability, that is TQX, is equal to 1. right? This is something which is already known to us, that TPX plus TQX add up to be 1, right? Because the probability that a person survives or a person dies within the next T years are mutually exclusive and exhaustive events. That means that they cannot occur together, and that is all the possibility there is. A person will either live or he'll die within the next T years, right? So these are all the possibilities that are, and we know that the sum of the probabilities of mutually exclusive and exhaustive events is always equal to 1. Thus, TPX plus TQX is equal to 1, right? So DTPX plus T can be written as 1 minus DTQX plus T, right? Which is quite obvious. Okay, now what you can do here is you need to apply the definition of DTQX plus T, which we have defined in assumption number 2, right? Assumption number 2 said that DTQX plus T is equals to DT times mu X plus T plus order of DT plus O of DT plus small o of DT. Right, so this DTQX plus T can be written as DT times the interval multiplied with the force of mortality, and you need to add a small adjustment term, that is O of DT. Okay, so I can just write this as, if I want to write it, I can write it as TPX into 1 minus DT mu X plus T plus O of DT. So this will give me TPX minus DT times mu X plus T into TPX. And if I multiply O of DT with TPX, that will stay O of DT, because and that's almost like zero. So you multiply anything with zero, it becomes zero only, okay? So this is what you have here, okay? And this is equals to DT plus TPX. Okay, now let's send this on the other side. So this would give me DT plus TPX minus TPX divided by DT. If I send this TPX on the other side and this DT on the other side as well, okay? So I'm just sending TPX on the other side and dividing the entire thing by DT. So on this side, I'll have minus mu X plus T because the DT is gone. And I'll have a TPX here, which was multiplied, right? And since I divided the entire expression with DT, so this O of DT will also be divided by DT, right? Right. So the entire expression is divided by DT, okay? Now, if you see this expression clearly, and we know that limit DT is tending to zero, because dt is a very small period of time, this expression can be viewed in the following manner, okay? If you see this expression clearly, this is the derivative of TPX. And why is that? Because the first principle of differentiation states that first principles of calculus or first principles of differentiation state, if you remember this says that f of x plus h minus fx divided by h when limit h tends to 0. This expression can be written as the derivative of fx, that is f dash x, or it can be written as d by dx of fx, right? This is the definition for the derivative of fx. Now here we have got, instead of h, you have got, dt, and instead of x, you have got a t, okay? So let's see how it works. So this is dt plus tpx. That is f of dt plus t minus tpx, that is the f of t, and divided by dt, that is the representative of h, okay? And limit dt is tending to 0, limit h is tending to 0. So you can just write this expression on the left hand side of this as you can actually write it as d by dt of tpx. And on the right hand side, you had, you'll of course have limit dt tends to 0 because we have applied the limit on both sides. So limit dt tends to 0 minus mu x plus t into tpx. And with this, you have got plus o of dt by dt. Now this expression o of dt by dt, when limit dt tends to 0, this entire expression will become 0 because we know this is the definition of o of h, that limit h tends to 0 o of h upon h is equal to 0. That is how I defined the order of h, right? So this is equal to 0, okay? And we are just left with this expression on this side, okay? So this becomes, since dt is gone, I can just remove dt. This is the derivative of tpx, and this, which is equal to minus mu x plus t into tpx, right? Okay. Now let's just simplify it a bit further. If I take this tpx on this side, that is, I divide the entire expression by tpx. So this becomes d 1 upon tpx into the derivative of tpx is equals to minus mu x plus t, right? Okay. Now let's just see what I can write this expression as. See, I know that the derivative of d by dx of the log of fx, f of x, for some function of x, the derivative of the log of fx is equal to 1 upon fx, which is the derivative of log, and then multiplied with the derivative of fx, that is f dash x. This expression can be compared with this expression, okay? This is same as this expression, okay? So this can be written as the derivative of the log of tpx, right? So this can be written as d by dt of log of tpx, and that would be equal to, on your right hand side, you have got minus mu x plus t, right? So finally, you can just write this as the derivative of log of tpx is equals to minus mu x plus t, right? And how you can finally get the value of tpx is that what you can do is write this in terms of s, okay? Let's write this in terms of s. Let's substitute s is equal to t here, okay? So that you have everything in terms of s, okay? So this becomes d by ds of log of spx is equal to minus mu x plus s. So I just did nothing, I just substituted t with s, okay? Now you need to integrate this expression, integrate with respect to s between limits 0 to t, okay? So if you integrate this with respect to s between 0 and t, your LHS becomes, going from 0 to t, d by ds of the log of spx, and I'm integrating with respect to s, so ds, minus integral of 0 to t mu x plus s ds, right? Okay, now if I integrate this derivative and this integral, they cancel out, okay? Or you can apply the rule of differentiating an integral, which is given in the starting of your tables. Whatever you do, the idea here is that derivative and integral are the opposite of each other, so the integral will cancel out with the derivative, and finally you just have to evaluate this log of spx at the limits 0 and t, right, which is equal to minus, going from 0 to t, mu x plus s ds. Right, now what I need to do is I need to put these limits. So this becomes log of tpx minus log of 0 px is equals to the negative integral from mu x plus s ds. Right, now 0 px, the probability that a person aged x survives for 0 years, okay, survives for at least 0 years. Right, this is the probability that a person aged x survives for at least 0 years. So this is a sure event that he will survive. That is for sure, okay? So this becomes 1. So this probability is 1. So the log of this would be 0, okay? So this entire expression becomes 0. So I'm just left with this expression, which is the log of tpx. Okay, 0px is 1 and the log of it would be 0, right? So I'm just left with the log of tpx, which is the negative integral from 0 to t mu x plus s ds. And if you put both of the sides in the power of exponential constant, that is e, so this becomes e to the power of log of tpx is equals to e to the power of minus integral from 0 to t mu x plus s ds, which implies that tpx is equal to, because the log and the exponential power, because log you have got a base e in the base, you can also write ln as log base e, right? So these two cancel out and this becomes tpx, and this is e to the power of integral from 0 to t mu x plus s ds. And this is the definition of tpx with respect to mu x plus with respect to the force of mortality. In terms of the force of mortality, this is the definition of tpx. Okay, and this is what you have studied in subject CT5 as well, right? So all this is saying is that the probability that a person aged x survives for additionally t years is that the probability that he does not die, that is why the minus sign, he does not die, this means he does not die because of the minus sign, between 0 to t, okay, which means that the force of mortality does not act upon this person between time 0 to t, that is when he'll survive from 0 to t, okay. And that's the interpretation of this is deeply covered in subject CT5, but this is the definition which you can see, okay. So the basic idea is that I am taking a negative of the force of mortality, which means that I do not want the force of mortality to operate or act on this person between times 0 and t, and that is when he'll survive from 0 to from time 0 to t, that is from the age of x to x plus t, right? So that's the basic idea here, and that is the definition for tpx. Now if I consider that this t is between 0 and 1, okay, I can apply the assumption of the constant force of mortality here, right? I can apply the assumption number 3 that I had taken earlier, that was the force of mortality is constant between integer ages, okay? So finally, if I take this assumption, then tpx becomes e to the power of negative integral from 0 to t of this mu x plus s is now a constant, that is mu ds, right, which makes it e to the power of, since it is a constant, it will come out, okay. And then if you integrate this with respect to s, it will give you an s. When you'll put the limit 0 to t, it will give you a t, okay. So this becomes e to the power of minus mu t, which is your definition for tpx when the force of mortality is constant, right? And this is the definition that you have seen in subject CT5.